In today's market, where humongous amount of data gets generated every day, it's very important to understand how to handle data. SQL Server is an integrated environment developed by Microsoft to handle data. So hi all, this is Sahithi from EduRekha, and I welcome you to this session on SQL Server tutorial. In this session, guys, we'll be getting into depth of all the aspects related to SQL. So without any further ado, let's take a look at the topics for today's session. But before we get started, subscribe to EduRekha YouTube channel and hit the bell icon to never miss an update from us on the top trending technologies. Also, if you're looking for an online training certification in SQL, check out the link in the description box below. So on that note, let's take a look at the topics for today's session. So the topics for today's session are as you can see on my screen. We'll start this session by understanding the types of DBMS, and then we'll look into what is SQL. After that, we'll look into what is SQL Server, and then I'll talk about the features of SQL Server. Once that is done, we'll look into how to install and set up SQL Server. And finally, we'll look into the SQL command categories, where I'll talk about the DDL command, DML command, DCL command, and TCL commands, and also the various aspects related to it, right? So I hope the agenda was clear to you guys. All right, so that's great. So let's start with the first topic, that is, what is database management system and what are its different types? Database management system, or most commonly known as DBMS, is a software application used to access, create, and manage databases. With the help of DBMS, you can easily create, retrieve, and update data in the databases. A DBMS consists of a group of commands to manipulate the database and also acts as an interface between the end users of the database. So if I have to just summarize DBMS for you, then DBMS allows the users to define the data, to update the data, to retrieve the data, and also for the administration of the users. When I say define the data, it allows the users to create, modify, and delete the definitions which define the organization of the database. When I say update the data, what I mean by that is that, you know, it provides access to the users to insert, modify, and delete the data from the database. Coming to retrieve data, it allows the users to retrieve the data from the database based on the requirement. And finally, coming to administration of users, it registers the users and monitors their action and enforces data security, maintains data integrity, monitors performance, and deals with the concurrency control. So guys, that was about DBMS. Now, there are mainly four types of DBMS, that is the hierarchical DBMS, the network DBMS, the relational DBMS, and the object-oriented DBMS. Talking about the hierarchical one, as the name suggests, this type of database management system showcases a style of predecessor and successor type of relationship. So you can consider it to be similar to a tree, wherein the nodes of the tree represent the records and the branches of the tree represent the fields. Coming to relational database management system, this type of database management system has a structure which allows the users to identify and access the data in relation to another piece of data in the database. In this type of database management system, the data is stored in the form of the tables. Coming to the network database management system, the network database management system supports the many-to-many relationships wherein multiple user records can be linked. And finally, coming to object-oriented database management system, this type of database management system uses small individual softwares called objects, and here each object contains a piece of data and the instructions for the actions to be done with the data. So if you ask me a few popular database management softwares, then they are MySQL, PostgreSQL, Oracle, SQLite, MariaDB, and Microsoft SQL Server. Now, all these softwares are based on different types of database management systems available in the market. So it's completely based on the user's choice, or I would say your choice, on which type of database you want to work on and what type of DBMS would benefit you more. So I hope that you've understood what is DBMS and what are the different types of DBMS. Now let's move forward with the next topic for today's session, that is SQL. Structured Query Language, or pronounced as SQL, or sometimes also known as SQL, is a standard language for dealing with the relational databases. Now, to explain you further, let me take an example for you. Now, if two people want to communicate with each other, then they have to use certain language which is understood by both of them, right? So if we consider these two people as one as the user and other as the database, then the language which is used to communicate between these two is nothing but the structured query language. So similarly, how a language has a grammar and various rules on how it could be used, even SQL has its own directives. SQL is effectively used to insert, search, update, delete, and modify the database records. And it doesn't mean that, you know, SQL cannot do things beyond that. It can do things beyond that also. It can provide you integrity checking. It can also provide you with embedded DML, which is used for general purpose programming languages. It has various sets of commands to create different kinds of views, tables, and other networks to understand the database effectively, and many such more. So guys, this was about the basics of SQL and DBMS. If you want to learn more about SQL, then you can refer to our session on what is SQL, and I'm sure you'll get a better idea of what is SQL. But since this session is based on SQL Server, let's get into the main topic for today's session, that is, what is SQL Server? Now, Microsoft SQL Server is basically a relational database management system which supports the structured query language and comes with its own implementation of the SQL language, which is known as the Transact SQL or the T-SQL. So it basically has an integrated environment to handle SQL databases, which is nothing but the SQL Server Management Studio. Now, the key components of SQL Server are, as you can see on my screen, we have a database engine, and this component is basically used to handle storage, rapid transactions, processing, and securing the data. Coming to SQL Server Service, this service is used to start, stop, pause, and continue the instance of the Microsoft SQL Server. Moving on to the next component, which is the SQL Server Agent, the SQL Server Agent service plays the role of the task scheduler and is triggered by any event or as per the requirement. Coming to SQL Server Browser, this service is used to connect the incoming request to the desired SQL Server instance. Coming to SQL Server Full Text Search, this is used to let the user run full text queries against the character data in SQL tables. Coming to SQL Server VSS Writer, this particular service allows backups and restoration of data files when the SQL Server does not run. Moving on to the next component, that is SQL Server Analysis Services, that is SSAS. This service is used to provide data analysis, data mining, and machine learning capabilities. The SQL Server is also integrated with Python and R for advanced data analytics. Coming to SQL Server Reporting Services, which is SSRS, as the name suggests, this service is used to provide features and decision-making capabilities, including integration with Hadoop. Finally, coming to the last component, that is SQL Server Integration Services, that is SSIS, this service is used to perform the ETL operations for different types of data from multiple sources of the data. So I hope that you have understood what is SQL Server. Now let's move forward with the next topic for today's session, that is features of the SQL Server. So the first one is user experience. So when I say user experience, what I mean by that is that, you know, SQL Server can be used on various operating systems like Windows, Linux, and Docker. So you just have to develop once and deploy anywhere with their consistent experience from on-premise to cloud, right? Not only this, but they make sure that, you know, you as a user get a consistent experience from on-premise to the cloud, and also provide easy-to-use tools and the connectors. So you can use the Azure Active Directory and the SQL Server Management Studio to manage your database infrastructure across on-premise SQL Server and also Microsoft Azure. So isn't that great, guys? Now moving on to the next feature is availability. So when I say availability, again, what I mean by that is that, you know, SQL Server makes sure that, you know, it provides high availability and disaster recovery. So with this, you can gain mission-critical uptime, fast failover, easy to set up, and load balancing of the readable secondaries with the enhanced SQL Server versions. So you can get unified solutions for high availability and disaster recovery on Linux and Windows. Not only this, but you can also put up an asynchronous replica in the Azure virtual machines for the hybrid high availabilities. So that was about availability, guys. Moving on to the next feature, that is performance. So when I say performance, what I mean by that is, you know, you can scale your price and performance in a parallel manner. So SQL Server makes sure that, you know, your real-world application performance benchmarks are set, and then your application using the SQL Server database is not failed down or is not turned down, right? So you can get great performance for your application, and it is also one of the highest performing data warehouses. Moving on to the next feature, that is analytics. So when I say analytics, what I mean by that is that, you know, SQL Server provides the built-in analytics, or you can say the built-in database advanced analytics. So with the help of the built-in analytics and the SQL Server machine learning services using R and Python, you can move beyond the reactive and into predictive and prescriptive analytics by performing advanced analytics directly within the database. So by using multi-threading and massively parallel processing, you'll gain insights faster than using open source R and Python. So guys, that is one major plus point of SQL Server. Now moving on to the next feature, that is security. So security, as the name suggests, I would say that, you know, it provides less vulnerable databases. So you can make sure that, you know, your data is protected in a proper manner, and it is less vulnerable to any other major attacks. Not only this, but you can also make sure that, you know, you have levels of security and compliance for the databases. Now coming to the final feature, guys, that is business intelligence. So obviously, as the name suggests, business intelligence is almost used in today's market in every company, and every company needs a manner to understand and visualize the reports and also gain insights, right? So SQL Server provides you with this feature and allows you to build comprehensive enterprise scale analytics solutions by benefiting from the fast performance of in-memory built into the tabular model. So basically what happens is that, you know, it reduces the time to insights using direct querying against tabular and multidimensional models. So guys, that were the features of SQL Server. So I hope that you have understood what is SQL Server and its features. So now that you know the basics of database management systems, SQL, SQL Server, let's move forward and install SQL Server. So to install SQL Server, what you have to do is you have to follow the steps that you can see on my screen. Initially, you have to install the SQL Server, and then you have to connect to the SQL Server using SSMS, that is the SQL Server Management Studio. After that, you have to access your database engine. I hope I'm clear with these points. All right, so let's start with the installation of SQL Server. So initially what I'll do is I'll install the SQL Server, then I'll connect to the SQL Server using SQL Server Management Studio, and then I'll access the database engine. Now to install the SQL Server, what you have to do is you have to go to this official website of Microsoft SQL Server download. Right, so I'll just go to this particular page. And once you go to this page, you see these two options, that is SQL Server 2017 on-premises and on the cloud. Now what this means is that, you know, you can either use SQL Server locally on your system or maybe on the cloud. So now what you have to do is you have to scroll down this particular page and you will see this option of developer and the enterprise edition. So here I'll be downloading the developer edition. So to download, you just have to click on this option of download now. Now you can see that, you know, the application is getting downloaded. So once the application is downloaded, what you have to do is you have to double click on this particular file and then you will see a window opening up. So let's just wait for that to happen. So as you can see, our application is opening up. Now once the application opens up, you see various types of installation types, that is the basic type, the custom type and the download media. So what I'll do is I'll just choose the basic type. So when you choose the basic type, you can select the basic installation type to install the SQL Server database engine feature with the default configuration. Just remember guys, when you're choosing the basic type, you're installing SQL Server with the default configuration. Moving on to custom type. So when you select the custom installation type to step through the SQL Server installation wizard, you choose the features, or I would say you choose the configuration based on your choice, right? So I would say if you're using it on an enterprise level, or maybe your complete company is using SQL Server, then I would say you can go forward with the custom installation, because you may have few features or you may want few configurations which must be same for the complete users, right? So that's when I would say you can go for the custom one. But if you're someone who is just using SQL Server on locally on your machine and then you just want to get hands-on experience in that, I would say go for the basic one, right? So on that note, I'll just choose the basic one. And then once I choose the basic one, you can see that, you know, we get this page of SQL Server license terms. So what you can do is you can just go through the license terms and then you can just click on accept button. So I'll just directly click on the accept button. And once I click on the accept button, you have to next specify the SQL Server installation directory, right? So that means where you want to install your SQL Server. So I'll just let it be as it is and then I'll click on install. Now once you click on install, you will see that all the required packages and the libraries are getting downloaded. Now let's just wait for the installation to complete. So as you can see, the computer requires a restart. So let me just restart my computer, right? So let's just restart. Now once the installation has completed, what you next have to do is you have to go to this customize option below to basically configure your SQL Server database, right? So I'll just click on this customize option. Now once you click on the customize option, this is a screen that you'll see. So over here what you just have to do is you just have to click on next, and once you click on next, you'll basically see that the files are getting installed, right? So let's just wait for that to happen and then you keep clicking on next. I'll tell you when you have to configure for something. So let's just wait for that to happen. All right. Now once the installation rules are also done, the next thing that you have to do is you have to choose the installation type. So since we are performing a new installation, we'll just choose this option of perform a new installation of SQL Server 2017. But yes, if you had any pre-installed SQL versions, then you'll choose the second option, right? So I'll just choose this option of perform a new installation of SQL Server 2017 and then I'll click on next. Now in the next wizard that opens up, you have to choose basically the type of edition that you had installed initially, that is the developer edition or the enterprise. So since I downloaded the developer edition, I'll just choose developer and then what I'll do is I'll click on next. Now after that, you have to read this license terms and then just click on this radio button of I accept the license terms and then click on next. Now in the next wizard that opens up, you have to choose the features which you wish to install. Also, you can choose the instance root directory and then click on next. So what I'll do is I'll just choose the features, let's say database engine, and then I'll let the root directory be the same and then I'll click on next. Now, after that, what you have to do is you have to name your instance and then this will automatically return an instance ID, right? So I'll just name my instance, let's say Edureka, right? And once I mention my instance name, you'll see that, you know, automatically my instance ID will be Edureka. So after that, what I'll do is I'll just click on next. Now in the server configuration wizard, just click on next. And then once you click on next, you'll be redirected to this database engine configuration. So over here, you have the Windows authentication mode and the mixed mode. So over here, what I'll do is I'll just choose the mixed mode and then I can mention the password, right? So I'll just mention the password and then I'll confirm the password. And then what I'll do is I'll just click on add current user and you'll see that, you know, automatically a user has been added. So this particular user will be the admin. After that, as you saw, I just mentioned the password and then I'll click on next. Now, once we click on next, you can see the summary of the installation, like what are the properties or the features which will be installed. So you can just go through that. And then what you can do is you can just directly click on install. So I'll just click on install over here. And now let's just wait for the installation to complete. Now, once the installation is complete, this is the wizard that you see. That means that, you know, our installation has completed. So I'll just click on close and then with this, we finish our installation. Now, the next step is to connect our SQL Server using the SQL Server Management Studio. So for that, what we'll do is we'll go back to this particular screen and then I'll click on install SSMS. Now, once you click on install SSMS, you'll see that, you know, you'll be redirected to a web page. So let's just wait for that to happen. So guys, this is the screen that you see once you click on install SSMS. Now what you have to do is you have to just click on this download option. So I'll just click on this download SQL Server Management Studio link. And then once I click on the link, you can see that, you know, the setup is getting downloaded, right? So let's just wait for that to happen again. All right. Now once the setup has been downloaded, just double click on this particular file. And then you'll see this particular screen. So over here, you can just choose the location or the installation directory for your SQL Server Management Studio. I'll let it be as it is. And then I'll just click on install. Now, once I click on install, you can see that, you know, our SQL Server Management Studio is getting installed. So let's just wait for that to happen. And once that is done, what we'll do is we'll basically access our database engine. So let's just wait for installation to complete. Now, once the installation is completed, you see that, you know, restart is required in order to do the complete setup. Now, once the SQL Server Management Studio is installed, you just have to open your SQL Server Management Studio from the Windows Explorer. So over here, you can just type in SQL Server and then you'll see this icon. So you just click on open. And once you click on open, this is basically what you see. Now, over here, what you have to do is you have to choose your server name. So you can just go for browse for more and just choose server name. And let's say we choose our desktop ID slash Edureka, right? That is because that is the one that we chose. So we gave our instance ID to be Edureka, if you remember. So I'll choose that and I'll click on OK. And then I'll click on connect. Now, once you log in, guys, this is the screen that you see. Now, the next thing that you have to do is you have to basically start your query editor, right? So before we get into the query editor and start using the commands, let's understand how does the SQL Server architecture look like. So the SQL Server architecture mainly has few components that you can see on my screen. So it has the server, it has the relational engine, the command parser, the optimizer, the query executor, and the storage engine. Coming to the server first, this is where the SQL services are installed and the database resides. Moving on to relational engine, this contains the query parser, optimizer, and the executor, and the execution happens in the relational engine. Moving on to command parser, well, this checks the syntax of the query and converts the query to the machine language. Moving forward with optimizer, this prepares the execution plan as the output by taking statistics query and the algebraic tree as input. Moving forward with the next component, that is query executor. Well, this is the place where queries get executed step by step, and the storage engine is responsible for storage and retrieval of data on the storage system, manipulation of data, managing and locking transactions. So you have a transaction log and then you have a data file. You also have a storage engine which has the transaction manager, the access methods, and the buffer manager. After that, we have the relational engine. Well, the relational engine has the optimizer and the command parser. and the command parser is connected to the query tree. And similarly, we also have the query executor, which executes the query, and the optimizer optimizes the query. Finally, we also have a protocol layer, which has the SNI, and then this is connected to the SQL Server network interface. Well, guys, this was about the SQL Server architecture on a high level. By now, I hope that you've understood and got a good understanding of the SQL Server. Now, let's move forward and get into the SQL command categories. Well, there are mainly four command categories that we're going to consider. That is the data definition language commands, the data manipulation language commands, the data control language commands, and the transaction control language commands. Coming to data definition language commands, well, this consists of the commands that can be used to define the database schema. Moving on to data manipulation language commands, well, this deals with the manipulation of the data present in the database. Coming to data control language commands, well, this deals with the rights and permissions and the controls of the database system. And finally, coming to transaction control language commands, and this consists of the commands which deal with the transaction of the database. So I hope that you've understood what are the SQL command categories. So before we move forward with the first command category, that is the data definition language command category, let me talk a little bit about the SQL Server data types. Well, there are various kinds of SQL Server data types present. So when I say data types, I mean what kind of data can be stored in your databases. So you can store exact numeric data types, the approximate numeric data types, the date and time values, the character strings, the Unicode character strings, the binary strings, and many other data types. So talking about the exact numeric data type, well, the exact numeric data type is used to basically store the numbers. So in this data type, you have other data types like the numeric, the tiny int, small int, big int, and so on. Moving on to approximate numerics, well, approximate numerics are used to store decimal or float value. So you have the float data type and the real data type. Coming to date and time, as the name suggests, this type of data type is used to store the date and time values in the database. So we have date, small date time, date time 2, and so on. Moving on to character strings. Well, this particular data type is used to store the character strings like char, varchar, text, and so on. The Unicode character strings are used to store the ncar, varchar, and ntext. After that, coming to binary strings, as the name suggests, again, are used to store the binary values. So we have binary, var binary, and image values in this particular data type. And in the other data type sections, we have data types like the cursor, the row version, hierarchy ID, unique identifier, and so on. Well, I would say once you get a hands-on practice on how to write queries and how to manipulate data in your database, you'll definitely understand which type of data type you need to use or you need to use to define your columns. So I hope that you've understood. So on that note, let's start with the first language command category, that is the data definition language commands. So to demonstrate the data definition language commands, what I'm going to do is I'm going to write few queries and then I'm going to explain how you can use that. So now what I'll do is I'll just add a query pane. So to do that, what I'll do is I'll just go to this new query option. And then you'll see that, you know, automatically our query pane opens up. Let me just zoom in a little bit. So now that I've zoomed in, let's get started with the session. So initially what I'll do is I'll just create a database. So to create a database, you'll type in a command create database, and then you'll mention the database name, right? So let's say I mentioned the database name to be students. Now after that, you just have to select this particular statement and click on execute. Now once you click on execute, you clearly see that, you know, the commands have completed successfully. So our database has been created. If I just refresh this particular section and then I go to databases, you see that, you know, we've got our students database, right? So now to perform any action in a database, you have to first use that database. So for that, you'll just type in use and then you'll mention the database name to be students, right? And then what you'll do is you'll just execute again, right? And once you execute again, you'll see that, you know, the commands have been successful. So that means whatever actions that you're going to perform is going to happen under this particular database. Now, after that, what you can simply do is you can just create a table, right? So to create a table, again, you just have to use this command of create table. Right, so I'll just mention create table and then you can mention the table's name. So let's say we just mention it to be students info, right? And then in brackets, what you have to do is you have to mention your column names and its data types. So the column names could be like student ID, let's say it to be of int, right? Next, let's say student name, let's say varchar of 8000. Similarly, we can have parent name. Again, of varchar, let's say 8000. After that, you can have phone number. Let's say big int because it's going to have a large value. After that, we can have address of a student, right? So I'll just mention address of a student. Again, varchar. Then I'll mention city, let's say varchar of 8000. Then I'll mention country, again of varchar, of 8000. After that, you can just close this, and then once you do, you can just execute this particular statement. So after the statement is executed, what you can do is you can just refresh this particular section, go to databases, go to students, and in students, you'll see that, you know, if you go under the table section, we find a table of students info. So that's how, guys, basically you can create a table also. Now, for example, let's say you want to drop a table. Now, dropping a table is also similar. You just have to use the command drop table, and then you mention the table's name. So that it is students info, right? So I'll just mention students info, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just execute. Once I execute, and then if I refresh, you'll see that, you know, our table is gone. So let's just wait for it to happen. If I go to table section, you see that there is no table present. So that's how basically you can create a table and drop a table. Now, similarly, you can also drop a database also. So to drop a database, what you have to simply do is you just mention drop database, and then you mention the database name, which was students. So I'll just execute. And then once I execute, you see an error that, you know, we cannot drop the database because it's in current use, right? So what you can do is you can just create another database. Let's say students one, and then we use students one. And then you can go back and drop this database of students, right? So once you drop this database of students, you'll see that, you know, a new database has been created, that is students one, and the students database has gone, right? So let's just wait for that to happen, right? So as you can see, we just have one database, that is students one, right? So that's how, guys, basically you can drop and create the databases and the tables. Now, the next command that you need to know in the DDL commands is the alter command. But before we start with the alter command, what I'll just do is I'll just use this particular database, and then I'll just create back this table again, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just write the alter command. So for example, let's say you want to add a column of blood, right? So what you'll do is you'll just mention alter table. Then you'll mention the table's name, that is students info. And then you'll mention add blood group. So that is basically a column name that we want to add. And then we'll mention varchar of 8000, right? And then I'll click on execute. Once I click on execute and go to tables, and then once we go to this particular table and go to columns on the left hand side, you clearly see that our blood group column has been added. Similarly, you can drop the same column also. So what you'll do is you'll just copy paste this, right? And then what you'll do is you'll just change the add function to drop function, right? So you'll mention alter table, and then you'll mention the table's name, and then you'll mention drop, and then you'll mention blood group varchar, right? So if I just execute this, oh, I'm sorry, I have to remove this particular data type also because we're not creating the column, right? So I'll just execute this particular statement again. All right, it says blood group is not a constraint. Now, this is one of the most common errors, as you know, people just remove the command and then try to remove that column. But what you have to do is you have to mention that it's a column, right? So for that, you'll mention alter table, table name, and then you'll mention drop column, and then the column name. After that, you'll click on execute. And then once you click on execute and refresh, you see that our blood group column has gone. So that's how basically, guys, you can add a column or you can delete a column. Now, for example, let's say you want to add a column and then you want to change the data type also, right? So you want to do both. You want to add a column and then you want to change the data type also. So what you'll do is you'll just mention alter table. We'll just copy paste this particular statement, and then we'll mention alter table students info, that is basically a table name. And then let's say we want to add a date of birth column, right? So I'll just mention DOB over here, right? And let's say our data type to be date, right? And then I'll just execute. Once I execute, you see that, you know, our column will be added. Now what I'll do is I want to change the data type, right? So to change the data type, what you do is we copy paste the statement again, and then I'll just remove this particular part, and I'll mention alter column, and then I'll mention column name, so that was date of birth, and then I'll mention the new data type, right? So let's say I want it to be date time, right? So I'll just mention date time and close, right? So that's how basically you can play around with DDL commands, guys. It's very easy and it's very interesting to learn with. So guys, that was about the alter command. Now let's say, you know, you want to truncate a table. So when I say truncate the table, what I mean by that is that, you know, you want to delete the information present in the table, but the table itself is not deleted. But before that, let's just include some information into the table. So to include information, you have to mention insert into, and then you'll mention table's name, right? So that's students info, right? And then you'll mention values. And then let's say I mention few values, right? So I'll just mention. So I'll just execute this particular statement. Oh, it says column name or number of does not match the table definition. We see this error because, you know, I forgot to drop the column of DOB. So I'll just drop the column. So to drop the column, I'll just mention alter table drop column and then I'll mention DOB, right? So let me just copy this particular section from here and then I'll execute the statement. And once I execute the statement, I'll execute the statement again. And then you'll see that, you know, our values have been inserted. Now to truncate the table, what you have to do is you basically have to use the syntax of truncate. So you'll just mention truncate and then you'll mention the table name. Our table name is students info. So I'll just mention students info and then I'll click on execute. Once I click on execute, we see that, you know, the commands have completed successfully, right? Initially our columns had few values, but now our columns have no values over there, right? Apart from this, if you want to also rename a table or rename a database, you have to use the command of sp underscore rename. So this is something different from the other databases, as generally the rename command or the query is used, but in SQL Server, you have to use sp underscore rename. And then you'll mention students one, that is basically our database name. And then you'll mention students info. And now you'll mention what you want to change it to, right? Let's say we want to change it to info students, right? And then let's just execute. Okay, it says it cannot find. So I'll just remove this particular part and execute. And once I execute, you can see that, you know, our table name has changed. So what I'll do is I'll just refresh this left hand side. And I'll go to students one, I'll go to tables over here. And then you can see that, you know, it has changed to info students. So I hope I'm clear with the DDL commands, guys. Well, these were a few basic commands that you need to know before you start handling and manipulating databases. On that note, let's take a look at the next topic for today's session, that is keys in the database. Now, the different types of keys used in the database are the candidate key, the super key, the primary key, the alternate key, and the foreign key. Now, coming to candidate key. Candidate key is a set of attributes which can uniquely identify a table. So a table can have more than a single candidate key, and out of the chosen candidate keys, a single key is chosen as the primary key. Coming to super key, this is a set of attributes which can uniquely identify a tuple. So candidate keys, unique keys, and primary keys are super keys, but the vice versa isn't true. Coming to primary keys, the primary keys are used to uniquely identify every tuple. So a table can have only one primary key, and that key will identify every tuple uniquely in the table. Moving on to alternate key, the alternate keys are those candidate keys which are not chosen as the primary key. And finally, coming to the foreign key is an attribute that can only take the values present as the values of some other attribute, and that is the foreign key to the attribute to which it refers. So guys, these were the various types of keys in database. So it's completely based on your understanding or how you want to design your database model, that which key should be primary key and which keys together can uniquely identify your table and so on. Apart from this, we also have few constraints which are very popular in the database. So next in the session, let's take a look at the popular constraints available in the database. So the constraints used in the database are not null, unique, check, default, and index. So talk about not null first. The not null constraint ensures that a column cannot have a null value. Right, so that is very simple. As the name suggests, it ensures that, you know, a column cannot have any null value. So if you just assign the constraint of not null to any particular column, then automatically you have to mention a value into that particular column to enter that particular tuple into the database. Coming to unique, the unique constraint makes sure that, you know, all the values in the column are different. So basically, when you mention a constraint unique to a specific column, then automatically what happens is that all the values present in the column are unique. So two or more values cannot be the same. Coming to check constraint, this constraint ensures that all the values in a column satisfy a specific condition. So whenever you mention the check constraint, you'll mention a condition, and all the values which satisfy the condition can be present in that particular column. Any value which doesn't satisfy the condition cannot be present in that particular column. Moving on to default, well, this constraint consists of a set of default values of a column when no values is specified, right? For example, let's say while entering values in a column, you forget to mention a few. But yes, while creating the table or maybe while adding a constraint, you add the constraint of default for that particular table, let's say 10. So all the places where you do not mention any value, 10 will be automatically added to that particular places. And finally, coming to the last type of constraint, that is index. This constraint is used to create and retrieve data from the database very quickly, right? If you want to create and retrieve data from the database very quickly, then you have to use the index constraints. So now that I've explained you keys and constraints in database, let me just switch back to my SQL Server Management Studio. And then what I'll do is I'll just execute few commands or queries based on this particular section. So let's get started. So what I'll do is I'll just copy this particular section from over here, right? And then let's say I just add a segment so that it's clear to us, and then I'll copy paste over here. And now let's say we want to use the not null constraint. So for example, let's say we want to make sure that, you know, the student name and the address of the student is definitely present, or maybe when the user is entering values, it's mandate for the user to enter the student name and the address of student, right? So then what we'll do is we'll just mention not null constraint over here, right? And again, I'll just mention not null constraint over here, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just create this particular table, right? Now, once this table is created, what I'll do is I'll just copy paste this insert statement from over here. I'll paste this, and let's say, you know, I just remove the address part, right? So I'll just remove this particular section, and then I'll mention null, and then I'll click on execute. When I click on execute, you can clearly see the error that, you know, cannot insert the value null into the column, because, you know, the column does not allow null. That is because we've given the not null constraint to the address column, right? So that's how basically you can use the not null on create table. Now, similarly, if you want to use not null on the alter table, what you basically have to do is you just have to mention the alter table statement, and then at the end you have to mention not null. For example, let's say I want to mention alter table students info, right? And then I'll mention, let's say, alter column, and then I'll mention phone number, right? And let's say I mention int not null, right? And then I'll just click on execute. And once I click on execute, you can see that, you know, the command has been successful. So whatever happens, you cannot mention the null values in the phone number column. So guys, that's how basically you can use the not null constraint on the create and the alter table. Now let's move forward with the next constraint, that was the unique constraint. Also, while working on the unique constraint, let's just check how to add the primary key. So what I'll do is I'll just drop this particular table. So I'll just mention drop table students info, right? I'll just execute, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just copy paste this section, paste it over here. So what I'll do is I'll just mention the unique constraint over here, and then what I'll do is I'll mention primary key, and in brackets I'll mention student ID, right? After that I'll just click on execute, and once I click on execute, you can see that, you know, the student ID will be unique. So every ID will be unique, and since every ID will be unique, it will uniquely identify every tuple, so that could be the primary key. So that's how basically you can add the unique constraint for a single column. Now let's say you want to add unique constraint for multiple columns, right? So similarly, what I'll do is I'll just drop this table again. I'll copy paste the section, paste it over here, remove the student ID, and remove unique constraint from over here. And then what I'll do is I'll just mention constraint, right? And then I'll mention the constraint name that I want to give. So it could be UC, let's say students info, and then I'll mention unique, and in the brackets I'll mention student ID, and let's say we want the phone number also to be unique, right? So we'll mention a phone number, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just execute again. So once I execute again, you can clearly see that, you know, our table has been created. So if I just refresh on the left hand side, right, and then what I'll do is I'll just go to the constraints part over here, or you can see that, you know, if I go to the column section over here, you can see that our constraints are clearly visible on the left hand side over here. Also, if I go to the key section, you can see that, you know, our students info constraint, which I just mentioned over here, is clearly present over here. So that's how, guys, basically you can add unique constraint on multiple columns. Now similarly, if you want to add unique constraint on an alter table, it's very simple. You just have to mention alter table, and then what you do is you mention the table's name as we previously did, and then we'll mention add, and we'll mention the constraint that is unique constraint, and over here we'll mention the column on which we want to add the unique constraint, right? So I want to add it on my student ID, so I'll mention student ID, and then I'll just execute, right? So that's how basically you can add a unique constraint on an alter table also. Now similarly, if you want to drop the constraint also, guys, you just have to mention alter table, and then you'll mention students info, and then what you'll do is you'll mention drop, and then you'll mention constraint, and then you'll mention the constraint's name, right? So for example, let's say I'll mention this particular name, and then I'll just execute the statement. Now if I just refresh this left hand side, and let's just open again, so I'll go to tables, I'll go to students info, and then if I'll just refresh, so I'll go to tables, I'll go to students info, and then if I go to keys, we see that, you know, there's no you see students info constant present, but then this particular constant that we had just added before on the alter table statement, that is present. So that's how basically you can add the unique constraint. Now let's move forward with the next type of constraint, that is the check constraint. Well, the check constraint, as I previously mentioned, is used to add a condition, right? So for example, let's say, you know, you want to add the check constraint while creating the table itself. So to do that, what I'll do is I'll create a table. But before that, let me just drop this table again. And now what we'll do is we'll just copy paste this particular section, put it over here, remove this part. And let's say, you know, we want our country to be India. So all the values which could be entered into the table must have the country value to be India, right? So we'll just mention check over here. And then in brackets, I'll mention country equal to, I'll mention India, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just execute this particular statement. So after that, let's say if I want to insert a statement. So for that, I'll just copy paste this particular section. Let's say I put it over here. And over here, let's say I just mention any value like nice road, right? And let's say we mention over here Germany, right? And I'll just try to execute. And once if I try to execute, you can clearly see the error that, you know, insert statement conflicted with the check constraint. The conflict occurred in the databases because, you know, the column country has to be India, right? And then we have mentioned Germany. So now what you can just do is you can just go back, change the country to India, and then you can insert the value. So that's how you can use the check constraint on the create table. Now let's say you want to use the check constraint on the alter table. Now similar to that of the unique constraint, what you'll do is you'll just mention alter table, and then you'll mention the table's name. And then what you'll do is you'll just mention add check, and in brackets you'll mention country equal to India, and then you'll execute. Now that's how basically you can add the check constraint on the alter table. Similarly, if you want to give the name to the check constraint, well, that's not necessary that you always give the name, but yes, if you're handling on an enterprise level and then you're handling a lot of databases, then giving a name must be a priority, right? So to add the name, what you simply do is you'll just use this alter table statement again, right? And then you'll mention the table name. And over here, you have to add constraint, right? And then you'll mention the name. So let's say I mentioned the check, let's say constraint name, right? And then what I'll do is I'll mention the check condition, and that is India. Right, so if I just execute the statement again, you'll see that, you know, it completely works. And if I refresh on the left hand side, go to tables, go to students info, go to constraints, you'll see that, you know, a constraint name has been added up. Right, now similarly you can drop a constraint. Well, dropping a constraint is again same, you have to use alter table students info, and then you just mention drop constraint, and you can just mention the drop constraint name. So I'll just execute this particular statement again, and you'll see that, you know, a constraint has been dropped. So guys, that was about the drop constraint. Now let's go forward with the default constraint. Well, the default constraint, as I previously said, is used to add the default value. So what I'll do is I'll just drop this table again, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just copy paste the section, paste it over here. I'll just remove this particular section. And then let's say our default country value is India, right? So I'll just mention default, sorry, spelling mistake. And then I'll mention India. So basically all the values which will be inserted into the table will have the default value India. So whenever there is no value that you enter, for example, let's say you are entering 10 values, and out of 10, 5 you have entered as Germany and 5 you have not entered any of them, then all those other 5 will get the value as India, right? So I'll just execute this particular statement, and then what you can just do is you can just check with the insert statement. So now similarly, if you want to add the default constraint with the alter table, you just have to again use alter table students info, and then what you'll do is you'll just mention add constraint, and let's say you give the constraint name to be, let's say, default, let's say country, right? And then you'll mention the condition, that is default, which will be India, and then you'll mention the column name, which is country, and then I'll click on execute. All right, it says that, you know, the column is already born. I'm sorry. So what we'll do is we'll add, let's say, city, and we'll just change it to city over here. And let's say we change it to HYD, right? And then I'll execute again. Once I execute, you can see that, you know, it's clearly working. Now to drop the default constraint also, it's very simple. You'll right click over here and just choose delete. And then once you choose delete, you can just choose the object name and click on OK. Right, so once you click on OK, you'll automatically see that, you know, your default constraint has been dropped. Now one more way to drop the default constraint is by using the alter table. You just have to mention alter table students info and then mention drop constraint, and then you'll just execute this particular statement, right? So that's how basically you can drop the constraint, guys. Now let's move forward with the next constraint, that is the index constraint. So the index constraint, as I said, is used for the fast creation and retrieval of the database. So for that, you'll mention create index. And then let's say we mention the index name to be, let's say, student name, right? And then I'll mention on which table, that is the student's info table, right? And then on which column. So you want student name from the student's info table, right? So I'll just create this particular index. Right. And then what I'll do is I'll just refresh this particular section. And over here, what I can do is I can go and check on my left hand side. Now, if you want to delete your index constraint, what you'll do is drop index and then you'll mention the index name. So I'll just mention index name and then I'll click on execute. It says that, you know, we must specify the table name and the index name. So I'll just mention the table name also. So I'll just mention table name dot index name. Right. And then I click on execute. And then you can see that, you know, our index constraint has been dropped. So that's how, guys, basically you can create, alter and drop your constraints. I hope you've understood what are keys and constraints and how you can manipulate your data based on those keys and constraints. Right. Now let's move forward in the session and go to the next SQL command category, that is the data manipulation language commands. So the data manipulation language commands are used to manipulate, or I would say retrieve, the data in the databases based on your requirement. Right. So to do that, what I'll do is I'll initially insert the values into the table. And then what we can do is we can just manipulate the data. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you the use command, the insert command, the update command, delete, merge, the select commands, the cube, the rollup, offset, fetch, top and pivot. And apart from that, we'll also discuss the various kinds of operators which can be used. So without any further ado, let's get started. So initially, as I was talking about the use command is used to use a database, right? So to use a database, as I just mentioned previously, you just mention the command use and then you'll mention the database name, that is students one. Now, after that, what you have to do is if you want to insert values, then you insert the values using the insert statement. So as you can see on my screen, it's insert into and then you mention the table name, values, and then you can mention the values required. So now what I'll do is I'll just drop this particular table so that all the constraints are removed. Right. So I'll just mention drop table students info. And then again, we'll create a table. Right. So I'll just copy paste from over here. Right. So once I just create this table, what I'll do is I'll just mention the insert commands. Right. So since I've already explained you the insert statement before, I'm not going to do that again. So the insert statement is simply used to insert the value. So there are mainly two ways through which you can insert the values into the table. Either you mention the column names and then you mention the column values. Else you can just mention the column values, right? So I'll mention insert into students info and these are the column names and then these are the specific values. Similarly, if you mention insert into values and then we can mention all the values which need to be inserted into the table, right? So I'll select all of them and then I'll execute. And once I execute, you can see that, you know, the table has values. So to check whether the values are inserted or not, what you can simply do is you can just type in select star from, let's say, students info, right? So we'll mention students info. And then I'll execute. And once I execute, you can see that, you know, all our values have been inserted. Now, let's say, you know, you want to update some data present in this particular database, right? For example, let's say for student ID with student ID 1, let's say we want to set the student name to be Ahana and then city to be Ahmedabad, right? So what I'll do is I'll mention update and then I'll mention students info and then I'll mention set student name, that is basically a column name, right? And then I'll mention the value, that is, let's say, Ahana. Right. And then also I'll mention city. Don't forget to put a comma over here. Right. So I'll mention city equal to Ahmedabad. Right. And after that, what I'll do is I'll mention the condition where student ID equal to 1. Right. And then I'll just execute this particular statement. And once I execute the statement, let me execute this particular statement again. And then you can see that, you know, the student name has changed to Ahana and the city has changed to Ahmedabad. So that's how basically you can update your data, guys. Now let's say you want to delete data from database. So to delete data, you'll just mention delete from, and then you'll mention students info where, and then let's say we want to delete the tuple with the student name Ahana, right? So I'll just mention student name equal to, and then I'll mention Ahana. And then if I just execute this particular statement again, you see that, you know, our student ID with the student name Ahana has been gone. So guys, that's how basically you can insert, update and delete values present in a database. Now let's say you want to use the merge command. Well, the merge statement is used to perform the insert, update, delete operations on a specific table where the source table is provided. So when you have two tables, let's say table A and table B, and then let's say table A is the target table and table B is the source table, and then we have few matched rows. So when we merge both these tables, we can see that, you know, we can perform the insert, update, delete operations on the tables, right? Well, the syntax to perform the merge operation is very simple. You just mention merge, and then you mention the target table name using the source table name, and then you mention the merge condition, and then if it matches, then you mention update statement. If it does not match, then you can mention the insert statement, and if it does not match by any source, then you mention the delete statement. So to understand the merge statement, let's just say we create two more tables, right? So what I'll do is I'll just create table, let's say sample source table, and let's say the columns to be student ID of int type, right? And then I'll mention student name of, let's say, varchar 8000 again, right? And then we'll mention the marks column of int type. Now similarly, I'll just create the target table also. So before executing, I'll just change the name to target, right? So I'll just mention sample target table, and then I'll just execute both these statements. Right now, after that, what I'll do is I'll just insert few values into the source table and the target table. So I'll just mention insert into, and then we'll mention sample source table. And then let's say we mention values, and over here we mention, let's say, first person with name Vihan, and let's say the marks to be 87. Similarly, let's just mention two more records, right? So I'll just copy paste, right? I'll just change this to 2, 3. Let me change the names and the marks. Now similarly, I'll just insert it to the target table also. So I'll just change the table name to be sample target table. So I'll copy paste from over here. And then I'll let the first record be the same. Let's say 1, Vihan and 87. And let's say we change it to 67. And 3, Saurabh. And let's say we change it to 55. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to merge both these tables. That means I'm going to merge the sample target table, and then I'm going to merge it with, by using the sample source table, right? So for that, I'll mention the statement merge sample target table, and then I'll mention target, using, and then we'll mention the source table. So it will be sample source table, and then I'll mention source on, and in brackets I'll mention target dot, let's say we match it to student ID, that is basically our condition, must match our source student ID, right? So we'll mention source dot student ID. So when it matches, what we want to do is when matched and target dot student, let's say name is, you know, same as source dot student name, right? Or target dot, we want marks is same as, let's say, source dot marks, right? Then we want it to update set. We want to update target dot student name equal to, the target spelling is wrong, source dot student name, right? Comma, we also want to match the marks, right? Target dot marks equal to source dot marks when not matched by target, then we want to insert, right? So we'll mention insert, and in brackets we'll mention student ID comma student name marks, right? And we'll mention values, we'll mention source dot student ID, similarly source dot student name, and source dot marks, right? And after that, when it doesn't match, right? So what we want to do is when not matched, we want to delete, right? So we'll just mention by source, then delete, right? So I hope that you've understood. Right, so what I'll do is I'll initially insert the values into the sample source table and the target table, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just show you what are the values present. So I'll just mention select star from sample table. That is our sample source table. So you can see that, you know, we have three tuples, that is with Vihan, Mansa and Ane having 87, 92 and 74. And then when we have the sample target table, we have again three tuples with Vihan, Mansa and Saurabh having 87, 67 and 55 marks. So now what I'll do is I'll just include this merge statement. Spelling mistake, right? So I'll just mention when not matched and then I'll just execute. So when I execute this particular statement, you see that, you know, two rows have been affected and then we see completion time, right? So if we just again click on sample target table, we see that, you know, we have our target table now having Vihan as 87, Mansa as 92 and Ane as 74. Initially, our target table had Vihan as 87, Mansa as 67 and Saurabh as 55, right? So that means our values have changed and our values have come from the source table. So that's how, guys, basically you can merge two or more tables. Well, that was about merging column, guys. Now, since I was using a lot of select statement, let me show you a few actions which you can perform on the select statement. So, for example, let's say you want to select a few columns, right? You'll just mention select and then you'll mention the column name. So let's say I'll mention student ID and let's say we mention student name, right? So there should be a comma over here from students info, right? So if I just execute this particular statement, you see all the values of student ID and student name from the students info table. Now, similarly, if you want to select all the columns, you'll just mention select star from the table name. So that's how you can use the select statement. Now, let's say you want to select the top three records from the table. So you'll just mention select top three star and then you'll mention the table name. So that will be, let's say, students info. And when I execute this particular statement, you see that, you know, we get the top three statements. That is the values for the second student, third student and the fourth student. Now, similarly, you can also find out the distinct values in a specific column also. For example, let's say we want to find out the distinct cities present, right? So we'll just mention select distinct and you'll mention city from and you can mention students info, right? And then let's execute. If I execute, you can see that, you know, we have Mumbai, Bangalore, Delhi, Kolkata as the distinct cities present. Now moving forward, let's say you want to use the order by, group by and the having clauses in the select statement. Well, to do that, it's really simple, guys. You just have to use those clauses. For example, let's say you want to select all the students from the students info table sorted by the, let's say, parent name. So for that, we'll mention select star from students info and then we'll mention order by parent name, right? And over here, if you do not mention anything, it will be ascending order by default. But let's say if you want it in a descending order, you'll just mention the keyword descending, right? And then you'll click on execute and you can clearly see that, you know, our students are sorted by the parent's name. So it starts with S and then goes to A. And then if you just remove this particular section and then you execute again, you'll see that, you know, our fifth student with the parent name Agarwal will be first on the list. Now that's how you can use the order by statement. Now this was just for one column. Now let's say you want to sort the data present in the table with different columns, right? So let's say we want to sort the students from the students info table by parent name and also the student name. So we'll just mention student name and then what I'll do is I'll just execute. And when I execute, you can see that, you know, since we haven't mentioned anything, whether it should be ascending or the descending order, automatically the parent name comes in the ascending order. So our fifth student comes first on the list and then the order follows. Similarly, if you just replace this, so for example, if you just put the student name first and then you mention the parent name and then you execute the statement, you'll see that, you know, the results are different because our student name will be first sorted in the ascending order. Now, apart from this, what you can also do is you can sort the data present in the table either in the ascending order or in the descending order for different columns, right? So what I mean by that is that, you know, student name can have the ascending order and the parent name can definitely have the descending order. So let's do the same. So I'll just mention ascending over here and over here I'll mention descending. Right. And then I'll execute. So once I execute, you'll see that, you know, the student names are sorted in the ascending manner and the parent names are sorted in the descending manner. So that's how all the students in the student info can be sorted by the parent name in the descending order and the student name in the ascending order. So guys, that was about the select statement. Now, this is one of the most popular statement which is used while manipulating data in the databases because, you know, this is one of the easiest way to retrieve data. And this statement is used with a lot of commands and other queries to retrieve data in the format the client wants. Now, moving forward in the session, let's say, we want to list the number of students from each city. Now, to list the number of students from each city, what you have to do is you have to take care of the aggregate functions. So the aggregate functions are basically those functions which are used to calculate the sum, the average, the count, and the range, the first, and so on. So don't worry, I'll be talking about them later in the session. But for now, if I just have to implement and show you, you can just mention select count, and then you can mention, let's say, student ID, right? And then you can mention city from the table name, that is students info. And then what you can do is you can simultaneously group them by city, right? So because we want to count the number of students from each city, we just group them by city, and then we use the count function. And then we execute the statement. You see that, Mumbai has one student, Bangalore has one, Delhi has one, and Kolkata has one. So guys, that was about this particular query. Now let's say you want to use the grouping sets. Well, grouping sets were introduced in SQL Server 2008 and were used to generate a result set that can be generated by union all of the multiple simple group by clauses. So the syntax is also very simple, guys. You just have to mention select, and then you mention the column names from the table name, group by, and then grouping sets. And in the brackets, you mention all those column names which have to come under the grouping sets. So for example, let's say I'll just modify this particular query, right? So I'll just mention select, and then I'll remove the count function. Let's say I mention select student ID, and let's say I also mention student name, right? And then I count the number of cities from the student's info table, and then I group by, and then I again use the grouping sets. So I'll mention grouping sets, and in brackets, what I'll do is I'll mention the grouping sets, right? So for example, let our first set be student ID, student name, right? So let me just press on enter so that's clear. And also, let's say we have city. Now, let's say in the other set, we just have student ID, right? And in the next one, I just have student name, right? So I'll just put in the bracket. And in the last one, let's say we just have a city, right? So these are various sets that we have created, right? And now we can just execute this particular query. You can see that, student ID, student name, and no column name, that is basically a count of city from students info. And then it's grouped by basically these four sets, that is student ID, student name, city in one set, student ID in the second set, the student name in the third set, and the city in the fourth set. For example, let's say for student ID, which is null, and student name is null, the count is one. So guys, that's how you can use the group by clause and the grouping sets together. Now let's say you want to use the having clause. Well, the having clause is generally used in the scenario where the where keyword cannot be used, right? So if you observe, generally in the select statements, we use the where keyword. So in the scenario where the where keyword cannot be used, we use the having clause. So let's say, if you want to use the having clause, let's say we want to count the number of students from a specific city. And let's say, their count should be one and should be ordered by, let's say, student ID with descending order, right? So what we can do is we'll do select count, and then I'll mention student ID, comma city. And then I'll mention from, obviously, the table name, right? Students info. And then I'll mention group by city, having count, and then over here I'll mention student ID again equal to one has to come out. And then let's say we order by count, let's say student ID in the descending manner, right? So I'll just execute the statement. We can see that Mumbai, Bangalore, Delhi, and Kolkata have come with their count having one. So that's how you can use the having clause, guys. Now, let's say you want to create a backup of this table, that is the students info table. So to do that, what you'll do is you'll just mention select star into, and you'll mention the backup table's name. So let's say we mention students backup from, and then I'll mention the table name, that is students info, right? And then I'll just execute, and then you'll see that, automatically the backup has been created. Now, this is where we just included all the columns and the tuples from the students info table to the students backup table. Now, let's say you just want to select only few columns from the students info table. Well, to do that, what you'll do is you'll just mention few columns, that is select, and then you'll mention ABC column from the table. Apart from this, you can also mention conditions also. For example, let's say you want to retrieve only those students who are from the city Pune. So you'll just mention whatever column values that you want to retrieve, like select student ID, student name, and so on into the table, that is the table name from students info where the city will be Pune. So for your better understanding, let's just write that. So select star into, let's say we mentioned Pune students from students info where city is equal to Pune, right? And then I'll just execute. So if I just execute this particular statement, you'll see that, you know, we have no values present because there was no student with the city Pune. So now what you can do is you can just go back and change the city name and then maybe drop the table and create the table again. So that's how you can play around with the select statement, guys. Now let's move forward with the next DML command, that is the cube command. Well, I would say that, you know, the cube is an extension of the group by clause. So it basically allows you to generate the subtotals for all the combinations of the grouping columns specified in the group by clause. So for example, let's say, you know, you want to use the cube statement. So what I'll do is I'll just mention select student ID, right? And let's say we also mention count, we mention city from students info, and then we mention group by, and then we mention cube, and I'll mention student ID order by student ID, right? And then I'll just execute. So when I execute, you can see that, you know, we have four students. So each student belongs to a single city. Now, similarly to the cube statement, you can use the rollup statement. So the rollup is again also an extension of the group by clause. And this allows you to include the extra rows which represent the subtotals. So these are referred to as the super aggregated rows along with the grand total row. So similarly to that of the cube clause, so I'll just mention for the rollup clause. So I'll mention select student ID count city from students info group by, and then over here I'll mention roll up, and then I'll just remove this order by statement, right? So you can just click on execute, and then you'll see that, you know, the null equal to 4 will come at the bottom of the table. So when you executed the cube statement, what you observe was that, you know, the super aggregated value, that was basically the subtotal, came in the first row. But when you execute the roll up statement, you see that, you know, it comes in the last row. So that was about the cube and the roll up, guys. Now moving on to the next DML command, that is the offset clause. The offset clause is used with the select and order by statement to retrieve a range of records. It must be used with the order by clause since it cannot be used on its own. Also, the range that you mention must be equal or greater than 0, right? So if you mention a negative value, then it shows an error. So to demonstrate this, let's just create a table, right? So I'll just mention create table, let's say offset marks, and then I'll mention marks int, so that will be our table column, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just insert values into this, right? So I'll just mention insert into, and let's say I'll mention offset marks, and let's say I mention a few random values, right? So initially I'll just execute this particular statement, and after that what I'll do is I'll just execute the statement. Before that I forgot to mention values over here, right? So I'll mention values and execute this, and similarly I'll execute the other statements. So let me just copy paste, and I'll just change the values over here, and then I'll execute again. Now after that what I'll do is I'll use the offset statement. So I'll just mention select tar from, I'll mention the table name, that is offset marks, order by marks. And then we want to mention offset one row. So that means our first value, which had 61. So when we use this order by marks, we see the table values to be sorted on 61, 62, 64, 65, and 65. And after that, when we say offset one marks, the first tuple will be deleted. So that is the reason we get only 62, 64, 65, and 65. So that's how we can use the offset statement, guys. Now let's move forward with the next one, that is the fetch statement. Well, the fetch clause is used to return a set of number of rows. So it has to be used in conjunction with the offset clause, right? So to do that, what we'll do is we'll just mention select star from offset marks, and then we'll mention order by, let's say, marks, right? And then what we'll do is we'll mention, let's say, offset three rows, and then fetch next two rows only, right? So we'll just fetch the next two rows after leaving the first three rows, right? So if I just execute this particular statement, we get the two rows, that is 65 and 65. Now similarly, you can also select the top three records from a table by using the top keyword, as I had mentioned previously also. So if you just mention select top three star from offset marks, you'll get the top three tuples from the table. So guys, that was about the offset clause and the top clause. Now let's move forward with the next one, that is the pivot. Well, the pivot is used to rotate the rows to column values and run aggregations when required on the remaining column values. Now the syntax of pivot is also very simple, guys. You just mention select non-pivoted column name, and then you've mentioned first pivoted column name as a column name, and then so on till the last pivoted column name as a column name from, and then you mention a select query which produces the data as a pivot, and then in the pivot section you mention the aggregation function for the column name. So what I'll do is, to give you a detailed understanding, I'll consider an example. So I'll just create a supplier table which has a supplier ID, the days of manufacture, the cost, the customer ID, and the purchase ID, right? Our supplier ID should not be null, right? And then what I'll do is, I'll just insert few values into it, right? So let me just execute this statement first, right? After that, I'll just go back and then copy paste this section. And then what I'll do is, I'll just insert. After the values have been inserted into the table, now what I'll do is, I'll just select the customer ID, the average cost, as the average cost of the customer from the supplier table, and then I'll group it with the customer ID, right? So for that, I'll just type in the command select customer ID, comma, average of cost as, and then I'll mention, let's say, average cost of customer from supplier table, group by, let's say, customer ID, right? And then I'll just execute the statement. So once I execute the statement, you see that, you know, we have the customer ID 11, and then the average cost of all the customers with the customer ID 11 is 1676. Similarly, all the customers with the customer ID 22 have the average cost of customer as 4654. And similarly, for the third one, that is 33, we have 5238, right? Now what we're going to do is, we're going to create a SQL pivot table with one row and three columns. So over here, if you observe, we had three rows. Now what we'll do is, we'll just create the pivot table with one row and three columns, right? So for that, we'll just type in the command select, let's say, average cost of customer as, let's say, we just change it to cost according to customers, right? And then we mention 11, 22, and 33, and then we mention from, and in the inner section we mention select customer ID, right? And then we mention cost from supplier table as, let's say, source table. And then what we'll mention is, we'll mention pivot, and in brackets we'll mention average cost for customer ID, and in brackets we'll mention 11, 22, 33 as pivot table, right? So I'll just mention pivot table, right? And then I'll just close, right? So I've just mentioned select average cost of customer as customer according to the customers, 11, 22, 33. So we have one row and three columns. We want to select customer ID and cost from the supply table as source table, and then continue, right? And so I'll just execute. So once I execute, you can see that, you know, the average cost of customers has been named as customer according to the customers, and we have 11, 22, 33. So over here, if I just drag, you can see that, you know, the average has been put over here. So basically, in our previous table, which were rows, have now become the columns. So that's how, guys, you can create a SQL pivot table. Now, similarly, you can unpivot it also. For example, let's say I create a table, sample table, and in that I mention supplier ID, let's say int AAA of int type, let's say BBB of int type, and CCC of int type, right? And then I just type on go, and then I mention insert into, let's say, sample table, and then I mention values, right? In brackets, I'll just mention, let's say, 1, 3, 5, 6. Right, similarly, I'll just mention the other values also. So let me just copy paste. Right, and then I'll click on go. So I'll just execute the statement. Right, and now what I'll do is, I'll just show you the value. So I'll just mention select star from sample table. Right, and I'll just execute this. Once I execute this, so you can see that, you know, we have three rows and four columns. Right, so we have the supplier ID, and then we have AA, BB, and CC. Now what we'll do is, we'll unpivot it. So to unpivot it, what you have to do is, you have to mention select, let's say, supplier ID, that is basically a column names, and then we'll mention customers, and let's say products from, and in brackets again I'll mention select supplier ID, and then I'll mention AAA, BBB, and CCC, and I'll mention from sample table, right? So I'll just give a space, give sample table, and then I'll mention unpivot, right? And over here I'll mention products for customers in, and in brackets again I'll just mention the values, that is AAA, BBB and CCC as, let's say, example, right? And then I'll just put on go, right? And then I'll click on execute. Once I click on execute, you can see that, you know, what we had as four columns and three rows has now been converted, right? So for every customer that is AAA, the products show three. The values that we have entered previously are shown. For example, let's say AA, which had value 398, are now put into three different rows. Similarly goes for BBB and CCC. So that's how you can unpivot the table also, guys. Well, that was about a little bit section of the DML commands. Now, if you want to know in depth about SQL pivot and unpivot, I'll leave a blog link in the description box below and you can refer to that. Well, guys, that was about this part of the section. Now let's move forward with the next part of the session, that is operators. Now, I would say operators is a very important part of the session because operators play a very important role to handle and manipulate data, or I would say different ways to retrieve the data, right? So the different operators present in the SQL server are the arithmetic operators, the assignment operators, the bitwise operators, the comparison operators, the compound operators, the logical, the scope resolution operators, the set operators, the string concat, and the aggregate functions. So talking about the arithmetic operators first, well, the arithmetic operators have the addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and the moduli sign, right? So you can just add, subtract, multiply, divide, or find the remainder. Coming to assignment, the assignment operators are used to assign a value to the variable. Coming to the bitwise operators are used to perform the bitwise AND, OR, and exclusive OR operations. Moving on to the next operators, that is the comparison operators. Well, the comparison operators are the relational operators which are used to perform comparison operations like greater than, less than, equal to, greater than, equal to, not equal to, less than, equal to, and so on. Moving on to the compound operators. Well, the compound operators are used to perform the compound operations of addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, moduli, AND function, OR function, and the XOR function. Coming to logical operators. Well, the logical operators are used to perform logical operations between the data. So these are generally used in the nested queries. So the different kinds of logical operators are, as you can see on my screen, like all, and, any, between, exists, in, like, not, or, and some, right? I'm not going to go into the depth of each one of them because, you know, it's completely based on your understanding of how which operator will benefit you better. But I would say the more you practice, the more you will have an understanding about the different operators. Moving on to the next type of operator, that is the scope resolution operator. Well, this operator is used to define the scope. And after the scope resolution operators, we have the set operators. So in the set operators, we have the union operator, the intersect operator, and the minus operator. So the union operator is used to combine the rows from both the queries. So when you have a left query and right query and you perform union operator, and then you apply the union operator, then automatically you will see that, you know, it will combine rows from both the queries. Coming on to the intersect operator, well, the intersect operator is used to keep the rows which are common in both the queries, right? So for example, there could be few common queries in both the left query and the right query. Then when you apply the intersect operator, only those queries will be taken into account. And finally, coming to the minus operator, the minus or the except operator is used to keep the rows from the left query which are not present in the right query, and the vice versa, right? So when you have two queries or the two tables, let's say left query and the right query, when you say A minus B, then it keeps all the rows from the left query which are not present in the right query. And if you say B minus A, then it keeps all the rows from the right query which are not present in the left query, right? Now coming to string concat operators. Well, the string concat operators are used to perform various actions on the string, like, you know, string concatenation, then wildcard characters to be matched, the wildcard characters which match just a single value or maybe multiple values and so on. And finally, coming to aggregate functions. As I previously spoke about in the session, aggregate functions are used to find the sum, average, count, min, max, first and last values. So all of these operators are very simple to use, guys. For your better understanding, let me give you a few examples, but I would say the more you practice, the more will you benefit, right? For example, let's say you want to use the arithmetic operator additions. You can just mention select 40 plus, let's say 60, and then you can just execute. Once you execute, you see the output as 100. Similarly, for example, let's say you want to use the comparison operators, let's say greater than equal to, right? So for that, you'll mention select star from, let's say we choose a table offset marks where marks is greater than or equal to, and then you mention, let's say 62, and after that you'll just execute. So you can see that, you know, you will get all those tuples which have marks which are greater than or equal to 62. Now similarly, you can also use the compound operators also. For example, let's say let's just declare two variables. So I'll just declare, let's say, at the rate var 1 of int type, let's say to be of 30, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just set it to be divided by, let's say, 16, right? So for that, I'll just use this compound operator and then equal it to 16, right? And then I'll mention select at the rate var 1 as example, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just execute. Oh, it says that we must declare it first. I'll just declare it first, and then what I'll do is I'll just mention var 1, right? I'll just set as 16. I'll just execute it again, and when I execute it again, you see the example as 1. That is because, you know, when we divide 16 by 30, our quotient is 1. So similarly, if you use the moduli symbol over here, then you'll see the reminder, right? So I'll just execute it again, and then you see the reminder to be 14. So that's how you can use the compound operators. Now let's say if you want to use the logical operators, right? For example, let's say if you want to find out the marks between 62 and 65, what you'll do is you'll just mention select star from, and then you'll mention offset marks where, and then you'll mention marks, which is a column name, and then you'll mention between, and then you'll mention 62, and which is again a logical operator, and you'll mention 65, right? Okay, my bad, this has to be select, and then I click on execute. So we get all the marks between 62 and 65. Now for example, let's say we want to find out those marks which are greater than 62 or marks which are equal to 67. So what we'll do is we'll just change this statement. So select star from offset where marks, and then we'll use the comparison operators, are greater than 62 and, or I would say, or marks equal to, what did I say? It was 67. And then I'll execute again, and then you see that, you know, marks greater than 62 are just 64 and 65. So we get that, and since there are no marks which are equal to 67, we do not get that. Now let's move forward with the next one, that is the like operator. So the like operator is one of the most popular questions asked in your interviews. Now this is since people often get confused between how to use the like operators, right? So for that, I'll just show you a few examples. So let's say, you know, we want to find out all those students' names starts with, let's say, S. We'll just mention select star from, and then we'll use students info, right? Where I'll mention student name like, and then what I'll do is I'll mention S, right? And then I'll mention the percentage symbol. So when I execute, we see that, you know, only one student with the name Shania, because her name starts with S, is in the result set. Well, that was about this query, guys. Now, for example, let's say, you know, you want to find out the student name whose name starts with M and the name has 6 letters, right? So what I'll do is I'll just mention select star from student name like, and then I'll mention M, and then I'll mention 5 underscores, and then mention a percentage symbol, right? And then I'll click on execute. When I click on execute, we again see only one query because Mansa's name starts with M and has around 6 letters, including M itself. So the 5 underscores were for the rest 5 letters and M was the starting letter. And percentage symbol represents anything can be there after that, right? So that was about this particular query. Now let's say we want to find out all those tuples whose student name starts with M and then ends with A, right? So I'll just change this particular query only. I'll just remove the underscore and then put a percentage symbol and mention A. What I mean by this particular statement is basically that, you know, the student name should start with M, should end with A, and any number of letters can be present in between. Well, that was about this particular query, guys. Now let's say you want to use the scope resolution operator to access the get root member of the hierarchy ID type. Well, to do that, what I'll do is I'll just declare a variable. So let's just declare at the rate example ID of hierarchy ID type. And then what I'll do is I'll select this particular ID, right? So I'll just mention select at the rate example ID equal to hierarchy ID. And then I'll mention the scope resolution operator, and then I'll mention get root. After that, I'll just print at the rate example ID, that is basically a variable, to string. So basically, I'm just converting it to string, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just execute this particular set of statements. And then once I execute the set of statements, you see this output, right? So that's how you can use the scope resolution operator also, guys. Well, that was about this particular operator. Now let's say you want to use the string concatenation operators. Well, to use the string concatenation operator, let me just consider the example of select. Let's say we take student name right? So I'll just mention student name, right? And then I'll put a plus mark over here. That is, I'm using the string concatenation operator, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just use single quotes, right? I'll put comma, and then I'll put a plus sign again, and then choose parent name, right? And then I'll just use the aliases function. That is, I'm combining these two columns and putting it as another column. And let's say I just mention it to be name from students info, right? And then I execute. So as you can see the output, you can clearly see that, you know, we've got a name column which has the concatenated values of the student name and the parent name. So if you want to give a space, then you have to mention spaces over here, right? And then you click on execute again, and then you can clearly see that, you know, the space is visible. So that's how you can use the string concatenation operators, guys. Now let's say you want to move forward with the aggregate functions. Well, aggregate functions were used before also when we were doing the order by and the group by clauses. For your better understanding, let's say if you want to just calculate the average of all the marks, you'll just mention select, and then you'll choose average marks, right? So that's basically a column name. And then you'll mention the table name, that is offset marks. And then you click on execute. So once you click on execute, we get our average of all the marks present. So that's how you can use the aggregate functions also, guys. Now let's move forward with the set operators. Well, as I explained before, the set operators consists of union, intersect, and the except operations. So what I'll do is I'll just consider another table which is similar to that of our students table. So I'll just create one more table. So let me just scroll up, right? And I'll just copy this particular section. Come down, paste it over here, change it to, let's say, students details, right? And then I'll also insert few values, right? So let me just copy paste from over here so that it's faster. So I'll just execute this particular statement now. And now once our table has been created, I'll just execute these three statements again. And now there are two tables, students info and students details, and both of them have few values. Now let's just perform the union operation, the intersect operation, and the except operation. So I'll just mention select star from students info, and then I'll mention union, and let's say we mention select star from the table 2, that is students details, right? So I'll just search for students details, right? And let's just execute. Now once we execute, you can clearly see that, you know, all our table values have been inserted. So we had few values in our first table and a few values in our second table, so all the values got combined into our third table, right? Now similarly, if we just do the intersect option, so I'll just mention intersect, and then we can see the common values in both the tables. So I'll just mention intersect and execute. And we can see that, you know, the fourth and the fifth record are common in both the tables. When I type in students info except students details, all the tuples which are present in students info and not present in student details are given as output. And similarly, if I just do the reverse, right? So if I just change it to students details except students info. So let me just do that. And then I'll just do it to info over here. You'll see the opposite output, right? So that's how basically, guys, you can use the set operators. I hope that you've understood how to use the different kinds of operators to manipulate and retrieve and handle your databases. Now let's move forward with the next part of the session, that is nested queries. Now nested queries are also one of the most popular concepts that you need to know, because, you know, nested queries are SQL queries which have an outer query and an inner subquery. So the subquery is a query nested within another query, such as the select, insert, update, and the delete statements. So this was about the nested query, guys. So as you can see on my screen, we have an outer query and then we can have a subquery. So what will happen is that, you know, first the subquery or the inner query will be executed, and whatever output comes, that output will be the input to the outer query, and then we get the final output. That was about the nested queries, guys. So for your better understanding, if I have to give you an example, we can just write a query like, you know, select student name and let's say parent name from, we mentioned students info, right? And then I'll mention where address of student in, and then we can have an inner query which says select address of student from students backup that we had initially created, where let's say country is equal to India. Right, and now we can just execute this particular query and then we get the output. So that's how you can type the nested queries, guys. Now let's move forward with the next part for today's session, that is joins. Now, joins in SQL are commands which are used to combine rows from two or more tables based on a related column between those tables. So they are predominantly used when a user is trying to extract data from the tables which have one-to-many or many-to-many relationships between them. Now, there are mainly four types of joins that you have to understand, guys. That is the inner join, the left join, the right join, and the full join. Now, the inner join returns the records which have matching values in both the tables. The left join returns the records from the left table and also those records which satisfy the condition from the right table. The right join returns the records from the right table and also those records which satisfy the condition from the left table. And finally, coming to the full join returns the records which either have a match in the left or the right table. So for your better understanding, what I'll do is I'll just consider an example. So apart from the student's info table, let's just consider the subjects table, right? So for that, I'll just create the subjects table. So let me just type in create table subjects. And let's say we have subject ID of int type, right? And let's say we have student ID of int type. Then we have subject name of, let's say, varchar type. And after that, let me just insert few values. So I'll just mention insert into subjects value 10-10 maths and 2-11 physics and 3-12 chemistry. So I'll just execute these statements. Now, once the statements are executed, let's apply the join functions. So let's say we want to apply the inner join, right? So we'll just mention select subjects dot subject ID and let's say students info dot, and we want the student name, right? From both these table, from, we want from subjects table, that is our table A, and then we'll mention inner join, that is our join condition, and then we'll mention the second table name, that is students info, and we'll mention on, and after that we'll mention the condition, that is subjects dot student ID must match students info dot student ID, right? And then we'll just execute this particular statement. And once you execute the statement, we see that, you know, there are no common values present. So that is the reason we do not get any values. Well, guys, that was about the inner join. Now, let's say we want to apply for the left join, right? So what I'll do is I'll just select students info dot student name. And let's say we also select the subject ID from the subjects table. And let's say our first table is students info, right? So that is what we are considering over here. And over here, I'll mention left join. And after that, what I'll do is I'll mention the other table name, that is subjects, and then I'll mention on, and then what I'll do is I'll just match the students info.student ID equal to subjects.subject ID, and then let's say we order it by the student name, right? So I'll just mention students info, let's say student name. Right, now I'll just execute this particular statement, and then we can see that, you know, we get all the values from the left table, that is the students info table. And then also those records which match the condition from the right table. Similarly, if I apply the right join over here, you'll see all the records from the right table and also those records which satisfy the condition from the left table. Now, finally, let's apply the final type of joins, that is the full outer join. And then let me just execute. And once I execute, we see that, you know, we get all those records which have either a match in the left table or the right table. So, guys, this was in short about the different types of joins in SQL. Now, if you want to learn in depth more about the SQL joins, you can refer to my session on SQL joins. With that, guys, we come to an end to the joins part of this particular session. Now, let's move forward to the stored procedures. I'm sure that, you know, you might have an understanding of what stored procedures are. Stored procedures are those reusable units that can encapsulate a specific business logic of the application. So it is a group of SQL statements and logic compiled and stored together to perform a specific task. The syntax of stored procedures is as you can see on my screen. Right, so you just have to mention create or replace a procedure, and then you mention the procedure name, and after that you'll mention the parameter's name, and then you'll use the aliases is or as, and then you say begin, right? And when you say begin, you declare the section, and then finally you end the procedure. So to demonstrate this, let me just create a procedure for you. So let's say we create procedure, let's say students city, right? And then we choose the parameter name to be scity. And let's say it to be of varchar type 8000, right? And after that, we choose as, and then we select from students info. And then we can mention where city equal to @, and then we mention it to @ as scity. Then we create go. And after that, we mention select star from students info again. Now once it is created, what you can do is you can just execute the statement simultaneously also. So for that you'll just use in the command execute, right? So execute students city, right? And then you'll mention @scity, because that is the type of the variable that you've created, and let's say it to be of Hyderabad, right? And then you'll click on execute. So once you click on execute, you can see that, you know, you select all the students from the students info, and you see that, you know, there's no student from Hyderabad. For example, if we mention Kolkata over here, right? So I'll just mention Kolkata, right? And then if I execute it again, you can see that, you know, we get an error that, you know, there's already an object named student city. So I'll just execute this particular section, and we see that we get only those tuples whose city has Kolkata value. So that's how, guys, you can use stored procedures. You just write the code once and then you can keep using it again and again like any other programming languages. So guys, that was about the stored procedures. And with this, we come to an end to the DML commands. Now let's move forward with the next section of commands, that is the DCL commands. So as I mentioned before, the DCL commands are used to grant or revoke privileges to a user. So for example, let's say you want to create a user. So to create a user, what you can do is you can just mention create login sample with, we mentioned the password to be edureka. So this will basically create a user. So I'll just execute the statement. Okay, it says that, you know, the sample user already exists. So I'll just mention it to be sample one, right? And then I'll click on execute. And once I click on execute, you can see that, you know, my user who's with the name sample one and password edureka has been created. Now what you can do is you can just use this user to perform various actions rather than only using the admin login. So this is how you can create a login sample one with the password edureka. Now to create a user, what you'll mention is you'll mention create, and then you'll mention user edureka, right? And for login, and then you'll mention sample one. So to create a user, what you initially have to do is you have to create a login for that particular user, and then you go forward and create a user, right? So I've created a login, and then I'll just create this user. So I'll execute this, and now this particular user can be used rather than just using the admin login credentials. Now what you can do is now you can grant and revoke any kind of privileges to a specific user. Now for example, let's say you want to grant few privileges for this user edureka, right? So for that you'll type in grant select on, and then you'll mention the table name, let's say students info, right? And then what I'll do is I'll mention two, and then I'll mention the username, that is edureka. So I'm just granting this privileges to this particular user. Now similarly, I can also revoke back the granted privileges. So I'll just go back and choose revoke. So I'll just mention revoke over here, and then I can just go back and execute, right? So once I execute, you can see that, you know, no privileges are there. Also, if you want to check, you can go to security, you can go to users over here on the left hand side, and then you can choose edureka. And then once you choose edureka, once you double click on that particular user, you can see all kinds of permissions granted to this particular user. So since none are granted, you can't see anything presently. But yes, if you grant some, then you can definitely see over here. So guys, that was about the DCL commands. Now let's move forward with the next section for today's session. That is the TCL commands, or the transaction control language commands. Well, these commands are used to handle the transactions in your database. To demonstrate this, what I'll do is I'll just create a table. So I'll just create a table and insert few values. So let me just copy paste the same. I've just created a table as TCL sample with the student ID, student name, and marks columns. And then these are the values which will be inserted, right? So I'll just click on execute. Now, once these values are inserted, now let's just start our transaction, right? So to start a transaction, what I'll do is I'll just mention begin try. So that's a try catch block, which I'll come to later in the session. So don't worry. After that, I'll mention begin transaction, right? And then I'll mention insert into TCL sample. That's our table name. And then I'll mention values. And let's say we mention few values, let's say 5. And then I mention the name. And let's say we mention other values, right? So I'll just mention 56. This need not be in code, so I'll just remove that, right? And after that, what I'll do is I'll just mention update TCL sample. That's our table name. And then I'll mention set student name equal to, let's say we mention the student name to be Akash, where our student ID is 5. Also, we want to update our TCL sample table again and set our marks equal to 67, where our student ID is 5, right? After that, we want to commit this transaction and then print that transaction completed, right? So I'll just want to print on the screen, and then I'll end my try block, right, and begin my catch block now. And over here I'll mention rollback transaction, and over here I'll mention again print transaction unsuccessful and rolled back. After that I'll end my catch block. So if you observe over here, what I've done is I've just started my try catch block and then I've begun my transaction. After that I've inserted a value into the table. Now after that I want the value to be updated, right? So I want to set the student name to be Akash with the student ID is 5 and the marks to be 67 with the student ID is 5. After that I want to commit the transaction and print transaction completed. And then only if there is no error, the try block will end. But if there is any error found or any exception found, then the catch block will be executed, where it will print transaction unsuccessful and rolled back. So what I'll do is I'll just execute the statement. Okay, I'm sorry, I missed a comma over here, right? And now let me just re-execute the statement again. And once I execute the statement, you see an output that, you know, transaction completed. That means that, you know, we have inserted this value into the table and then we have also updated the values, right? So I'll just show you that. So let me just type in select star from TCL sample, right? So when I execute, you can see that, you know, we have our fifth student with the name Akash and the marks to be 67. Now let's say, you know, you set the marks to 67 by 0, and then let's just execute the section again. Now once I execute the section again, you clearly see an output that, you know, transaction unsuccessful and rolled back. That is because, you know, we cannot set our marks as 67 by 0, as we have given that, you know, marks column is an int column. And then an int column cannot have this particular kind of values. So that's how, guys, the transaction control language commands works, right? With this, we come to an end to the different SQL command categories that you need to understand about. Now let's move forward with the final topic for today's session, that is exception handling. Well, exception handling in SQL Server is almost similar to that of the other programming languages. It's the same as you handle exceptions in all the other programming languages. You have a throw block and then you also have a try catch block. So talking about the throw block first, or I would say the throw clause, this clause is used to raise an exception and transfers the execution to a catch block of the try and catch construct. If you want to see the syntax is as you can see on my screen. You mention throw and then you mention the error number and then you can mention local variable, message and so on. Coming to the try catch block is used to implement exception handling in Transact SQL. So a group of statements can be enclosed in a try block. So in case an error occurs in the try block, the control is then passed to another group of statements that are enclosed in the catch block, as we just saw in the transaction control language commands. So the syntax is as you can see on my screen. It starts with begin try, then we mention few SQL statements, then we mention end try, then we mention begin catch, and then we again mention few SQL statements, and then we mention end catch. So that's how you can do exception handling, guys. So for your understanding, let me just give you a quick example. So let's say if you want to use the throw clause, you'll mention throw. And then I said, you'll mention the error number, right? So let's say I'll mention 5,100. And let's say I mention it as record does not exist, right? And then what we can just do is we'll put a comma and then put on one. And then when I execute this particular statement, you can clearly see that, you know, message 51,000. And then you can see that, you know, state line is one and the message is record does not exist, right? So that's how you can use the throw clause. Now, similarly, you can use the try and catch block as you saw before. So for that, you'll just type in begin try, right? And let's say we select phone number plus student name, right? So if you remember, our student name was of varchar type and our phone number was of begin type, right? So we cannot concatenate both of them. So I'll just mention phone number concatenate student name from students info. And then what I want to do is I want to do end try. Then I'll begin the catch block. Right, and then I'll mention print not possible, right? And let's say I'll just mention end catch, right? And then we can just execute the statement. So when I execute this particular statement, you see that, you know, no column name, but if I go to messages, you can clearly see that, you know, the message shows not possible, right? So that means our try block did not get executed, only our catch block got executed and shows the exception of not possible. That indicates the user that, you know, we cannot add these two columns. So that's how you can perform exception handling in Microsoft SQL Server, guys. With this, we come to an end to this particular session. I hope you found this session informative. So if you have any further queries related to the session or related to Microsoft SQL Server, please comment down in the comment section below. Until then, that's all from my side today. I hope you found the session informative and then you get good hands-on experience in the SQL Server. Hopefully, you will also crack your interviews for database administrators and start handling data in the database management systems. On that note, that's all from my side today. Thank you and happy learning.
I hope you have enjoyed listening to this video. Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries, and we will reply them at the earliest. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to EduReka channel to learn more. Happy learning!